So that's always interesting to me. But I did bring some things with me today because I thought a wonderful topic for us to address would be time, since we've just gone through this time change. And so looking at that concept of time through the eyes of the miraculous, or through the eyes of unity. And I was just, as I was sitting in my seat and we were doing the unity principles, I thought, what would happen if we, you know, had some kind of a earth-shattering disaster and there were only things left years and years from now, centuries from now, that were buried, and somebody came upon this and saw these principles. And if there were, everything else was destroyed, and this was one of those tablet kind of things that was found in timelessness, and what people would think of us as a world, if this was only the only thing they found. They'd think what evolved, and amazing, and caring, and wise, and present, and loving people. And they would think that's what we've been on the planet during this time, occupying this space. So when we say these principles and when we embody these principles, it's so much more than that, because this is the evolution of consciousness that we would like to experience in our own time, so that we can make our time on Earth worthwhile. So A Course in Miracles says that there's no time in heaven. And A Course in Miracles already says you're in heaven. You already abide in heaven. So here we are with all the world getting a little bit topsy-turvy today. People sleeping late, not sleeping late, feeling like their worlds are getting all kinds of shifts around. Because in the world of form, we really care about time and space. But we've had a lot of people who come before us, people like Einstein, who were more mystically oriented, who got their cues from tapping on heaven's door, that there was something going on here beyond what we typically experience. And so the theory of relativity, about time being relative to where we are. And most people think that means physically where we are. But what happens if we look at where we are in relation to heaven? So if in heaven there's no time, and on earth there's time that we go through, think about this. When was a time in your life when you were particularly happy or in a blissful place? Maybe you were on vacation, maybe it was when, you know, you had a new baby in the family born. Maybe it was during a wedding, a happy, joyous celebration. But think of how fast that time went, and how, you know, people always say when people are during their wedding, the married couple don't have any recollection of the wedding, that it goes so fast. Same thing people say about life with children, you know, put them in first grade, and before you know it, you blink and they're in college. Time goes so fast. And so when we cherish things or love things, the essence of heaven, we find ourselves in timeless states. And when we judge things or experience ourselves in the opposite of heaven, when we let fear drive our motivation, then time goes on forever. So I see that we have some young people in the audience. And I remember sometimes when I was young and I was going to school and I was told to be the good girl and be quiet in the class or raise my hand when I needed to speak. And I considered myself a good girl and a good student. But there were some times when that clock on the wall was the only thing I could see. And I felt like I was in torture to sit in that classroom that I, please let the bell ring, you know, make it be 3 o'clock, because it would feel like time just dragged on and on, and you look at the clock again and only 3 minutes had gone by, or you're watching that second hand and it was endless and excruciating. And now think about times in your life where, say, you didn't like the occupation that you were in the midst of, whether it be a job or some kind of family duty, raking leaves, snow shoveling, whatever it was,
And think of how long, how every shovel feels like you're climbing Mount Everest, and it's just endless. So to notice how important it is that our judgments color our experience of time.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't really, really get this until I woke up to the fact that one day I was in the supermarket, and I had small kids at the time, and I was getting bliss attacks just walking down the aisle. And I realized I had a clear mind. I wasn't thinking at the time. Typically before that, I had my list, and it was like, you know, what am I getting the kids for lunch, and who's going to eat what, and I'd make three different dinners at night. And I was like so exhausted because somebody wanted pasta, somebody never ate vegetables, and dinner was my endless time too. It was like, oh, the end of the day, it's been such a long day, and now I have dinner. And so I used to go in a grocery store, like, get that stuff off the shelf and put it in the cart, get it in there as fast as possible. And now I'm in the store, actually just being in the store, walking down the aisles, feeling bliss.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember it dawned on me in the most unlikely of places, the grocery store. Well, I said, what's going on here? I was watching myself trying to figure out how come, you know, last week it felt like this, and this week it feels like this. It's completely different. One was close to hell, hellish, and the other is heaven. What happened? And as I walked along, I realized I'm not judging anything.
Mm.
I'm like looking at labels saying, wow, that's cool, look at this stuff. And I'm noticing all this stuff got to us. If you know, I wanted to grab people in the aisle and say, look at this. Where I'm just walking down the aisle, I can get something from Colorado. I can get something from another country. I can't believe this.
Mm.
And I was feeling gratitude,
mm-hmm.
which is also a timeless
mm-hmm.
place to be.
Mm-hmm.
So there's an interesting thing. In Greek mythology, there are a couple of gods that are dedicated to time. One is Kronos, and that's how we get chronological time.
Mm-hmm.
The time that we live in as human beings. And the other is Kairos. Kairos is the god that if Kairos came, it was like, great, I might meet the person of my dreams, like that. And synchronicity came, and if Kairos came, you paid attention. What's paying attention? Being present, being here now. In that state of timelessness. And so Kairos was the one that everybody celebrated because things happened out of pattern. Things happened that were miraculous.
Mm-hmm.
A Course in Miracles says, miracles collapse time and space. So Kairos shows up, and everybody allows for a new experience to take place miraculously. You don't have to know anything.
Mm.
There's no judgment involved.
Mm-hmm.
So people would pray to the god Kairos because they got it that this was a different time. This was God time.
Mm-hmm.
This was eternal time being interjected into the continuum of chronological time.
Mm.
So in Greek mythology, they worked together, but people celebrated when Kairos shows up. So I would say here, in this community, what we've afforded ourselves by looking at these unity principles with our hearts and souls, deeper than with just two eyes in this chronological world. But I'd say what we've afforded ourselves is a doorway to the miraculous. Really, what are we doing? With our time here, we dedicate it all to the miraculous. Sincerely. So there's a different thing to know about miraculous time and why it's like Kairos time. Why it's an insertion. I use a lightning bolt to symbolize the work that I do because I don't do process. When a lightning bolt hits, you could try and try with all your might to find out what's going on way over there. I have to walk there, I have to drive my car there to find out what's happening. A lightning bolt hits and lights up the horizon and you see everything.
Mm.
Like that. And that's what the miraculous brings, knowledge, not intellect. I've just been in the world of intellect and man, trying a paper, I gotta read this book and find that paper and do this. And all these, look at this, all the books here. Beautiful, beautiful, wonderful knowledge. But hopefully everyone who wrote those books loved every word they put on the page. Because otherwise they're in chronological time and they're not getting themselves thrown into a different and heavenly state of being. So everything we do that's focused on love, the eternal energy of love, propels us into timelessness. Everything that we do with fear, and as you can see, boredom is fear. You know, how am I going to be stuck here forever and ever? What happens if I don't graduate and I'm stuck looking at that clock for the rest of my life? Or if you're in bliss, which is a creative mindset, you bring something here that never belonged or never was here before, fresh on the planet. And that does not come from thinking. That comes from inspiration. So if we were walking in the world of the miraculous, miracles we exchange between people. So we do that in chronological time. That's why these two gods, Kairos and Kronos, can work together. But when we are inspired, or revelation is like the lightning bolt experience. So it's the insertion into linear time. And to get that, you have to know that we are not journeying on a linear path here. That's our perception with human minds that have two eyes and two ears and two feet and two hands that work the world of duality. So I have a relationship with you and you're out there, and if I love you, wow, that time with you is, wow, how'd the time, where'd the time go? We never get enough time to be together. And if I don't like you, what am I going to, I don't even know what to talk about. Or, oh, I can't stand this experience. Well, anytime you feel like you can't stand an experience, then begin to stand in a vertical position with your life rather than a horizontal position. And what that means is the divine will always be above us in our perception of things. And then we, luckily, believing in these unity principles and believing in beautiful masters who have come before us, have masters like Jesus who can stand above us, being the mediator in between. Because sometimes it's just too hard for a human being to make that leap and go straight to God. And so there'll be people who we can emulate and we can say, wow, they were really masterful. They really got this. They came here with their eyes wide open, or their eyes got open to something deeper. But they weren't looking out there for the answers. They were only looking within themselves. And within themselves, they find the divine. So when we approach life that way, we wind up seeing things completely differently. Time and space collapses for us. Everything we do becomes much easier, much more, not only easy, it's like, you know, grease lightning. We find ourselves moving into positions and doing things that allow for us to be in that heavenly time. So there's a couple of commitments we have to make in order to be able to get there. You know, people feel lots of times in this, especially in these times we're in right now, where technologies have sped up things exponentially, and our capacity to do so much so frequently has made us feel like we actually have less time for ourselves. So this is something to grab a handle on right now. It really is, because otherwise we are going to diminish our own happiness if we don't get discerning with how we're using our time. And so when someone says, I don't have time for that, let's reframe that to, that's not my priority. Because if you're doing things that you don't love, be very well aware that you're prioritizing things that you don't love. Then you will be in a world where it feels like this is endless, which leads to all kinds of symptoms like depression. But if you choose love as your priority, and we all can do this, everyone can do this, I could say, you know, well, you know, my priority isn't to clean my bathroom, but offer me $10,000 to clean my bathroom and that's gonna be my priority. So you choose, and if you choose consciously what your priority is, you'll feel in complete alignment with yourself. And in that way, you'll show up able to love what it is you're experiencing. So again, we say, I did bring some notes that I did want to use here because I don't remember numbers very well. But there was a TED talk I saw on time. And the woman is a time management person. So she said, first of all, the first question that people ask me about time management is, I must manage my time really well. And she said, well, I have four small kids, so no, I'm not great at this. But I do know, after having done lots of studies about things, what people find as a way to help them manage their time effectively. And so she said, first of all, I want to banish some myths out there about time. We all say we don't have enough time. And she said, but I'm going to give you some numbers that banish that myth. The first number was that 24 hours in a day times 7 days a week equal 168 hours. That's a lot of hours in a week. It truly is a lot of hours in a week. Okay, so now say you work 8 hours a day, and that's another 40 hours you can take away from that. Still, that's a lot of hours left. You still have 128 hours. Now take away the 8 hours of sleep a night. That would be 56 hours, but still you're winding up with 72 hours a week free. And now if you work 10 hours more a week, still you've got 62 hours a week. And if you work 20 hours more a week, still you've got 52 hours, and most people say they do work that much, but they don't. Because they did the studies on the people who said, no, I work 75 hours a week, and they found out they really overestimated by 25 hours. They just felt like they were working that much. And again, what were their priorities? Maybe making a lot of money in a job they hated? Mm-hmm. So they think they're working 75 hours a week? And if you think you're working 75 hours a week, you are exhausted for the other 52 hours that you have left. So taking all that into account, that we actually do have a lot of time, even if you had 50 hours a week. So if somebody said to you, do you think that you could run, now train for a marathon, you know, 7 hours next week? You're going to probably say, I don't have time for that. But say I inserted into your life a situation where, I don't know, your car got destroyed, and you needed the car to get to work, and you had to get the car fixed or some way to do that, and that takes up, when you chart it out, 7 hours in the day, and you found time for that because you had to, because it was a priority. So instead of saying, as we're changing the clocks now, maybe this could be twice a year when we change clocks. Just check in and see, what are my priorities right now? What am I prioritizing in my life? Do I love that? Do I love my priorities? And I would suggest we don't do this under pressure. I like this time frame because it's not New Year's where everybody's making their resolutions and things. Mm-hmm. And it feels like so much pressure. And it feels like another performance. That's not what we're talking about, because there can't be any judgment here. Mm-hmm. This is between you and you. There's no space or time between you and you. You're in a timeless place. So what this woman suggested to do, which was really interesting and wonderful, I feel, is she said, look at those letters that come to people at the end of the year where our families will say all the great things that happened to themselves and in their life. And she said, you know, people like them and hate them at the same time. They don't sometimes feel like, wow, my life didn't live up to their life. But she said, what about if you looked at it as though you were taking a job evaluation or this letter at the end of a year, but instead of seeing it at the end of the year, see this for your next year. What would you write in the letter of your dreams to everybody that you love about your next year if it became the year that you wanted it to be? What would that letter say? And then write it. Those are your priorities. And what would you say about a great job evaluation that you had at the end of next year? Maybe you're working for yourself. You know, what kind of raise or bonus did you get a year out? You're manifesting it. We all know we're manifesting it. Let's do this in timelessness and in a miraculous way. The other thing she said that I thought was a great thing is she said people set goals on Mondays or the beginning of the week. Don't do that. Set it on a Friday afternoon when you're relaxed and people don't expect you to get anything done. Because Friday afternoons are typically throwaway times. Use that time to focus on yourself, and then when you do, have three categories. Have work or occupation, have your relationships, and then have personal. If you keep it all about your work goals, then you're going to have an imbalanced life. And you're going to ultimately, even if you love your work, you're going to ultimately find yourself not loving it. So if you, especially if you love your work, prioritize in the personal time and the relationship time. And then take your calendar for the next week and put them in like appointments. So that you've now made an hour, you know you've got all these hours. You've now got an hour for your personal time on Monday, an hour for your relationship time on Monday. You've got at least 3 hours a day. And if you start to prioritize this, I've learned this from my own personal experience that, you know, really time and space, you can stop aging, you can stop all kinds of things that we're afraid of when we're in this chronological time. In a way that it's chronic condition for us. Chronic condition. That's only conditioning. Allow yourself this vertical experience with the divine where you close your eyes and go inside and see what you love. And allow yourself to know what you love so that then you can walk out into the world and prioritize that love leads the way. That's a tangible, practical way to have love lead the way in our lives. Then it doesn't sound like these people are going to say, yeah, they're kind of flaky in that unity church. No, we have practical, tangible ways that love becomes the priority. And then can you help be exuberant and blissful and joyful because now you don't have to judge because you can just change your mind. Or your priority, if it doesn't work. No need to beat yourself up. Because just because the ego loves that and loves munching on that kind of food doesn't mean that that's good for us or whole for us or healthy for us or whatever the divine had ever intended for us. So we surrender our lives to the divine. And in that, we take all the faculties that we got, that we arrived on this earth with, and we serve the divine with it. We serve the divine with love. And if we happen to fall in the process of all of this at any time, there's a line in the Course in Miracles that's absolutely one of my favorite lines. Infinite patience brings immediate results. Have patience with yourself as you prioritize your life in a way that you love. I have to say, I talked last time I was here about the course that I was teaching kids who were killing each other in schools. And one of the things that I made them, prioritize in the course that was really hard for them to prioritize because they were used to living lives of drama. That's why they were killing each other. It was just their priority was to be cool and everyone else was doing this and they're all outside of themselves. So what I did to get them back to themselves was to make them have a creativity date every week. They had to do something that was between them and them, that if it was to go to a museum by themselves, most of them never ever went to a museum. Go to the movies, do anything, take a walk, to find a dog to pet. Do anything that you love that you would do in a vacuum that no one else's approval mattered. And you know what? That was the assignment that for the first 3 or 4 weeks, everybody didn't do. They didn't know how. They didn't know how to love themselves. They didn't know how to be with them. How can you be happy if you can't be alone happily? Of course you're going to let everybody else take the reins, and then you'll blame them for it. Judgment slows down the time and space. So getting back to that space where we realize that the divine relationship between us is meant to be love and solely love. We're meant to delight and surprise ourselves every day with our capacity to show up and see with the eyes of Kairos and allow for synchronicities to come, because that's divine time, that's God time. And we all deserve God time. So factor in the God time in your week. And it doesn't have to be through excruciating sitting and meditation. It doesn't have to be the only time that we're with God. We get it, and Colette said it, singing, dancing, doing anything, laughing, being with kids. Mm-hmm. Most people think they don't have time to be with their own families. Mm-hmm. And if you have that little bit of, if you have that much time, 52, 62 hours a week, you've got time there. And you're going to spend time with them anyway, but you're not going to be there. Mm-hmm. You're going to be totally unconscious of the gift that you got. And where'd the time go? So let's just take this all back now within our minds and hearts and allow ourselves just to recognize that we have one truly, truly, truly important relationship. And it's with the time we spend with ourselves. If we spend that time effectively in a loving space, that we prioritize all of our life around love and what we love. Because A Course in Miracles says your function is your happiness. Do not sacrifice for anyone else. You're doing no one else a favor. Half of you is no better than none of you. All of you is what we all want to arrive. So allow yourself now, sit back, take a big deep breath, and then as close as possible to the end of this service today, sit down with yourself. It's a Sunday. It was supposed to be the day of rest. You know, when I was young, the stores were closed and we couldn't occupy our time with anything but family. That was kind of where you got thrown in by default, which was wonderful. We didn't appreciate it as much because we didn't know this was going to happen. But sit back sometime today, since it's Sunday, your God day, and allow yourself to make those priorities for your work, whatever you feel is you worthy of your time in that regard, for your relationships, and for yourself. And then fill your calendar out a week forward just to try it out. Where you factor in that much love. See it as you factoring in, your priority is love. Factor in those love hours. And I promise you, if you do that, you're going to see yourself at the end of the week further and further away from the judgment and guilt, and closer and closer and closer to that vertical relationship with the divine. Even though you'll be walking the world, you'll be in it, but not of it. Big blessing.
Wow. Oh.